Out of the silken darkness of a desert dawn emerged the dream of Bikaner. You are now inside Junagarh Fort, the unconquered bastion of the Rathors of Bikaner, a major royal clan. We welcome you here to a page of history, even magic. The foundation of the fort was laid in 1588 during the reign of Raja Rai Singh. From the very battlements of this majestic stronghold, appearing from the mist of the arid sands, were the fortunes of this great desert kingdom governed. This was, for centuries, the residence of the rulers of Bikaner, their queens, and the royal families. It still remains the symbol of their authority, their majesty, and their power. And it is the reservoir of their legacy, their heritage, and speaks of their very soul. Bikaner was founded by Rao Bika in the late 15th century, almost 100 years before this fort was built. Colonel James Todd, the famous British historian, wrote in his seminal work, Annals and Antiquities of Rajasthan, that the area that Rao Bika selected for his capital city belonged to a Nehra Jat. However, he gave it up for Bika on the condition that his name should be remembered forever. Combining their names, the city became Bikaner. When Bika's fort was no longer strategically viable, it was decided to build Junagarh. The very walls breathe of the courage and virility of the Rathors. They are said to be descendants of Suryadev, the sun god. This fort has seen innovations and changes throughout its history. It was very common for every new ruler to add a new structure or build a palace of his own to put his own imprint, his seal, or to redecorate one that had been built earlier. Junagadh is, without doubt, the fort of great interiors. Junagadh is rather unique in that, unlike most forts, which are built on hillocks, this was built on the ground. It comes under the category of garh palace or fort palace, which means the elements of defensive architecture and residential palaces are combined. The fort walls are very thick and there was a wide moat all around it. The Suraj pole or sun gate, the main entrance, with its slightly pointed arch and its jarokhas, or windows, and galleries, is a simple yet powerful composition. The galleries served as a nakar khana, or drum house, from which the arrival and departure of the ruler was announced. There is a profusion of cupolas, balconies, ornate lattice-work friezes and tall octagonal section columns which are peculiar to Bikaner. There is much use of the bungaldar or curved roof in a modified form. In desert palaces, these are extensively used to cover shallow projecting balconies. The zanana, or the women's quarters, always had a separate entrance and was closed to all but the inhabitants. The condition of parda or veil necessitated the presence of carved jalis or screens across the windows from which the inmates of the zanana could look out, but nobody could look in. The men's quarters had more public rooms, the divan-e-am or hall of public audience, where the ruler met his subjects and also large delegations, the divan-e-khas, or hall of private audience, where the ruler met his more select guests, and which was often within the private rooms of the rulers. These private apartments often boasted a chitrashali, or picture gallery, a sheesh mahal, a bedroom often decorated with mirrors, and a temple. At the very top, you would find the Hawa Mahal, a room where the breeze cooled the apartment. This chowk or courtyard is named after Raja Karan Singh. It is also known as the Holi Chowk, since the festival of Holi was celebrated here. Courtyards had multiple purposes. They were used for splendid occasions of pomp and pageantry, such as the Maharaja's Darbar, for the public audience. They were also used for staging performing arts for the entertainment of royalty. Imagine evenings of song and dance under the full moon and a canopy of brilliant stars. Celebration of Holi, the festival of colors, which heralds the beginning of spring, would also take place here. Try and visualize the high spirits, the frolicking, the fun. The courtyard would be alive with plumes of color and the sprinkling of scented water. And unlike in other kingdoms, the merriment would go on long into the night. Upper courtyards also doubled as places to sleep in the hot, balmy months, and so became social places. To your left, see the balcony or jarokha, known locally as the Chini Burj. Observe the unusual white and blue pottery tiles that decorate it. They were reputedly made in China for the English market. Look up near the top of the building to the far right. You will see wall paintings of a different genre, painted in Maharaja Dungar Singh's reign. A train, a ship, and an elephant-drawn carriage. They show the advent of the British era and innovations brought in. It will interest you to know that Maharaja Ganga Singh was born in that very room in the year 1880. This painting depicts the victorious return of Rao Bika from Jodhpur with the ancestral heirlooms. Rao Bika, the founder of Bikaner, was the younger son of Rao Jodha, the founder of Jodhpur. Thus, both Jodhpur state and Bikaner state were ruled by the same clan, the Rathore Rajputs. Both traced their common ancestry to the erstwhile state of Kannauj in central India. The fact that an enemy advance on Bikaner was repulsed by the timely help to Bika by his father Rao Jodha suggests that the bond between father and son was still strong. Bika would have been a vigorous, valiant son, one to make any warrior father proud. Before his death, Rao Jodha tried to establish long-term peace between Jodhpur and Bikaner. He persuaded Bika to be satisfied with his kingdom and to leave Jodhpur to his elder brother, to which Rao Bika readily acquiesced. However, Bika made the condition that, should his elder brother die without an heir, then the ancestral family heirlooms from Kannauj ought to be rightfully with him. This was agreed to. However, when his elder brother died without a son, the next Jodhpur ruler refused to keep Rao Jodha's promise. Upset and angered, Rao Bika attacked Jodhpur and returned to Bikaner with the promised heirlooms. This can be clearly seen in the painting shown here. The heirlooms consist of the famous sandalwood throne of the kings of Kannauj, the royal umbrella, which you can see being held above Rao Bika in the painting, a diamond-studded shield, a large silver idol of the clan goddess Nagnechi, Nagara or drums, and several other items. Some of these are on display in this room, and each is clearly marked. You are now at the Anoop Mahal Chowk. Do note the finely carved lattice jarokhas or windows. These kept the women in parda or behind the veil and yet allowed them to observe any functions which were part of court life. The jalis also allowed circulation of fresh air and protection from the harsh sunlight. This courtyard was built by Maharaja Anoop Singh in the late 17th century. Besides being a great soldier, he was also an extraordinary scholar. His versatility extended to being proficient at medicine, astrology, and astronomy. He was also a great patron of the arts music and literature. His reign has been described as the golden age of Bikaner. The geometric design of the floor tiles, popular during the Victorian period, is a much later addition and was introduced by Maharaja Ganga Singh in the 20th century. This is one of the most unusual rooms in the fort. Built by Maharaja Sardar Singh and named after him, it is popularly known as Badal Mahal or Palace of Clouds. The visual impact of the beautifully shaded clouds of blue and white interspersed with lightning is dramatic. And do also observe the delicately painted rain at the bottom of the walls. It is said that since rain was so scarce in Bikaner, he devised this room so that one could get a feel of what the rains were like. The portrait of Maharaja Sardar Singh, surrounded by his courtiers and staff, as if enjoying the rain from his personal alcove, is visually very powerful and shows him to be, besides a man of stature, also one of a rare sensitivity. Sardar Singh was a great patron of the arts and music and was an accomplished composer and musician himself. His instruments, the veena and the garur veena, are on display in this room. He loved classical Indian music. The music you are now listening to is Rag Malhar. According to legend, this rag is so powerful that when sung, rain falls from the sky. You will also find here a unique apparatus that he devised to allow water to trickle down and so add sound to the aura and the intoxicating smell of rain on dry ground. We will now retrace our way back to Karan Mahal courtyard. In front of you are various insignia bestowed on Bikaner Maharajas by the Imperial Mughals. One of them is the Mahi Maratib, or the Order of the Fish. It is said to signify youth, bravery, firmness and strength. It is believed that the Order of the Fish was first instituted by a king of Persia. On the day of his coronation, the moon was in Pisces, and so he called it the Order of the Fish. The two large gold plates mounted on poles you see before you were called kokab and represent stars. These insignia would follow the Maharajas in processions and were also displayed in the court on special occasions. The Mahi Maratib was a rare distinction and awarded to only a limited number of the great territorial sovereigns by the Mughal emperors, who had established themselves as the central imperial power in India by the mid-16th century. Not once, but thrice did Bikaner's kings receive this rarest of honors. Many wondered about Bikaner's connection with the Mughals. In this arid land, Marusthali, the land of death, staying alive was hard enough. Bikaner was at the easternmost frontier of this desert land, and so close to insurgencies from Delhi. Therefore, after a few initial battles, Bikaner sought peace with the Mughals. It was better to make honorable treaties and so escape war and privation and continue with the building of the kingdom. And this suited the Mughals as well. It was a relationship of mutual need and respect. Many Bikaner rulers held a very high rank in the imperial Mughal court. They also ruled as governors of various provinces on behalf of the Mughal emperors. Hey. This magnificent room, the Diwan-e-Khas or Hall of Private Audience, is where the ruler would sit and entertain most of his highly placed officials and foreign guests. Anup Mahal is ornately decorated with lacquered walls covered in red and gold. You will see the rich relief in gilt stucco on pilaster depicting various gods. The strong marble columns are covered with delicate paint, and the entire effect is awe-inspiring. And the geometrically prepared ceiling with rich paint and gold lifts your spirits. Note the brilliant glass inlay panels above the throne. It catches the light and reflects into the room. To the right of the room, you will see a splendidly painted door depicting various religious themes. Each part of this room was created with much love. The beautiful artwork in Anup Mahal is locally called Munovat. The artists who created Anup Mahal are called Ustas. Ustas, from Ustad or Master, are a professional caste of artists who served the royal court of Bikaner for generations, from as early as the reign of Maharaja Rai Singh, the builder of this fort. They received special privileges from the Maharajas, including land grants and cash rewards for their work. The most celebrated Usta of Bikaner was Ruknuddin, who was largely responsible for the development of the late 17th century classic Bikaner court style. Best known for their skills in painting on paper, Ustas also painted on cloth, on wood panels, and even decorated festival statues, all usually with finer brushmanship than found anywhere else in Rajasthan. The beautiful artwork in Anup Mahal is the result of a painstaking process which requires patience and skill. The first step was to prepare a fine surface of lime over which the artist stenciled the decorations. After this, wet clay, derived from crushing old earthen pots, was applied over the stencil outlines to provide a relief. The artists used gums derived from extracts of local trees as a binding material. Artists then applied colors made from minerals and vegetables over the relief decoration: vermilion, turmeric, indigo, gold, silver, and lapis. The preparation of the gold paint was a laborious process and involved several steps. After the gold paint was applied with a brush, it was burnished to achieve a glossy surface. The gold was used to achieve a warmer color, silver to prepare a cooler ambiance. Ustas still practice their living art in Bikaner.